Good morning. Please take a seat. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to this wonderful occasion this morning, today's installation service. We're delighted that you've joined us for this very special occasion. My name is Paul Spilsbury. I'm the academic dean here at Regent College, and I'm going to be leading us in our service today. Today is a day for celebration. We gather to celebrate God's faithfulness to Regent over 45 years. We celebrate God's provision and God's guidance, and we make official the installation of Dr. Jeffrey Greenman, Regent's president. Now, if you look at the front page of your program, you'll see there that it says that we are installing the fifth president. Well, as some of you may know, that's not actually true, or correct. So let me clarify. The title used for the head of Regent College has changed over the years. At our origins, Dr. James Houston was the founding principal of Regent College. And we're delighted that Jim is here today. And if I could ask you to stand, Jim, we'd like to acknowledge you here. He passed the baton to Dr. Carl Armading, who was the second principal. Carl is also here, and he will be speaking a little bit later. Carl, would you stand too, please? Then the title changed to president with Dr. Walter Wright, who served between 1988 and 2000. He unfortunately could not be with us today due to a prior commitment. Then the fourth in line, the second president, was Dr. Rod Wilson, who served between 2000 and 2015. Rod is here as well. Rod, please. Which, of course, brings us then to the fifth person in succession as head of Regent College, and in very precise terms, technically the third president. But five looked better on the brochure. So with these introductions and a little history lesson accomplished, I'd like to again ask you to take up your program and we'll begin our service. All of today's service is found in the program. So please join me in the bold part of the program as we come to our call to worship, taken from Psalm 67. So the congregation's part is in the bold type. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face shine on us, so that your ways may be known on earth, your salvation among all nations. May the peoples bless you, O God. May all the peoples praise you.
May the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you rule the peoples with equity and guide the nations of the earth.
May the peoples praise you, God. May all the peoples praise you.
The land yields its harvest. God, our God, blesses us.
May God bless us still, so that all the ends of the earth will fear him. Please stand now for the opening hymn.
Thank you.
remain standing for our invocation.
Please join me as we pray together. God, you who are Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we declare that you are good, you are real, and you are present. We thank you for the privilege we have of gathering today to mark the installation of Regent College's fifth president, Dr. Jeff Greenman. And we ask you, Lord, that you would graciously help us to recognize, experience, and worship you more deeply as we celebrate what you have done and what you are doing in and for this college. So we say, come, Holy Spirit. We give this time to you, and we say that this service is yours. May it bring glory to you, our triune God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. A reading from Deuteronomy 6, verses 1 to 9. These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess, so that you, your children, and their children after them may fear the Lord your God as long as you live, by keeping all his decrees and commands that I give you, and so that you may enjoy long life. Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey so that it may go well with you and that you may increase greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, just as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on your door frames of your houses and on your gates.
A reading from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 to 16. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned it. This is why it says, when he ascended on high, he took many captives and gave gifts to his people. What does he ascended mean, except that he also descended to the lower earthly regions? He who descended is the very one who ascended higher than all the heavens in order to fill the whole universe. So Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow to become, in every respect, the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. From him, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows and builds itself up in love, as each part does its work.
It's my pleasure now to introduce Dr. Carl Armading, who will give the charge to the president. Carl is someone who knows Regent very well and is known to many here, of course, too. He played a central role in the early days of Regent College. He was one of the founding faculty members, taught Old Testament for many years, and then served as the second principal of the college between 1978 and 1988. That was a time of growth for the college and for the completion of the new building to house the college. Also, as a matter of interest, during that time that he had a certain TA, teaching assistant, by the name of Jeffrey Greenman. Carl, please come and speak to us.
Thank you, Paul. We also had a wonderful small group during a couple of those years, and a young couple named Paul and Bronwyn were part of that group, and those are the joys that we look back to. I do have a slight correction to make. Now, Paul, you don't have to rush out and redo all of the papers for this, but I was principal for the first 9 years, and then we were interviewing Walt Wright, and he was rather uncomfortable with this strange Canadian and British term, and he said, no, it has to be president. So the board passed that some 3-6 months before Walt arrived, so I was actually the first president of Regent College. And I'm also delighted to have been the second principal, and that's and when I think Jim and I feel a certain sense of pride that we got in at the beginning when the terms were authentic, right, Jim? Now, Jeff, I've reflected a lot during my days as principal slash president, and since that time on the things that one struggles with the most and the things that one needs the most in this office. Coming into the office is always a time of transition. Times of transition in the Old Testament were when the kings of the earth went forth to war. All you needed was an outgoing king and everybody ganged up on the new one. It was deemed to be a time when you could make hay because the new person was inexperienced and so forth. But when I've thought about what are the things that I felt were the biggest challenge and what is the thing that I needed most, the biggest challenge was fear. Now, fear, there's an anatomy of fear and it comes in all kinds of ways. I was thinking of perhaps one of the most famous statements from an American president that was used by Franklin Delano Roosevelt in his first inaugural address in 1933, right in the depth of the Depression. He said, "The only thing we have to fear is fear itself, nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed effort to convert retreat into advance." That's an amazing statement. It's worthy of the fact that it's gone into the literature as one of the great statements from the 20th century. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror that paralyzes efforts to convert retreat into advance. Now, any time we have a new president that comes into a college like Regent, it's a time when we expect advance. And yet, these days are days of retreat in theological education in a widespread sense. They're days of retreat in economy. They're days of retreat in many, many ways. And if we're going to be different from others, we've got to convert retreat into advance. And I know that's what Jeff and Roger and the board and the faculty are all about. But the thing that perhaps more than anything else I know that could rob us of that is fear. Now, that's to me one of the terrors that lurks by night. You lie awake at night and worry about things. We become fearful. What's the thing we most need? And as I thought about it, the thing I most needed was encouragement. We need courage, and I was taken immediately in my own thinking to Joshua chapter 1, where Joshua is in a time of transition. Now Moses, my servant, is dead. He's gone. You're at the edge of the river on the eastern side of the Jordan, ready to go across. And Joshua suddenly has this unruly people with a somewhat checkered history thrust into his hands, and he is supposed to lead them. God says to him three times in Joshua chapter 1, be strong and courageous. Be strong and very courageous. And it's interesting, the strength and courage breaks down into three separate areas, and I want just to mention them this morning as I challenge Jeff, and we challenge Jeff and charge him. The first, be strong and of good courage. Be strong and very courageous, because I am sending you to lead these people to cross the river, to go into the land which I swore to your ancestors to give to them. You're going to take them there. So the first need for courage has to do with grasping the future. Now, one of the things that has led to the downfall of many a leader is a failure to grasp the vision. And I was thinking of Joshua. Here's Joshua. Two and a half tribes have already been settled. They've been settled quite well. They defeated Sihon and Og, the Amorites and Bashan kings. They're settled in, and I can well imagine people saying to Joshua, this is not the time. This is not the place. Let's give it a little time. I was thinking back, and Jim and I and Ward will all recognize this, how many people warned us at the beginning that Vancouver was not the place, 1970 was not the time, the circumstances were bad, the economics were bad, nobody'd be interested in what we were doing, don't be fools. That's the advice we got. Job's comforters, they were, all of them. We needed courage in those days to grasp the vision, courage for the future. If God has said, go across the river, you don't stay on this side of the river. There's a land to be possessed, and the job of a leader and the job of the community is to grasp that vision and run with it. And so, Jeff, you need courage to do that, because the naysayers will still be around, I can assure you. If you haven't met them yet, I'll meet you after and we'll tell you about them. I could name a few of them. They're still... No. No. I've tried to forget. The second, be strong and very courageous, has to do with your history. Be strong and very courageous. Moses, my servant, is dead, but he has left you this law, which Phil read to us. A paraphrase of some of the things in Joshua chapter 1 come from Deuteronomy. This book of the law, don't let it depart out of your mouth. Meditate on it day and night. Be careful to read and understand and obey what is in it. And when we think of the future, which needs to be grasped, we also think of the past, which needs to be understood and coped with. You know, one of the problems we have with the past is we either magnify it all out of proportion, or we deny it, we forget it, and are forced to repeat it. I think of even the Israelites' history, Sihon and Og, king of Bashan. Just a few years after they had defeated him quite handily, what are they remembering? Well, they've got a museum where his iron bedstead is kept in the museum. And people are thinking, wow, Og, king of Bashan. Boy, there were giants in those days. And Moses was bigger than life. I could never be Moses. But you're called to be today's Moses, and you're called to go against today's Ogs and Sihons. So we have to look back at our history. We have to learn from it. We have to put it in perspective. And there's no better way to do that than to take the pages of Scripture, which interpret history according to the mind and will of God, and help us to understand what the past was all about, our past as well as the larger past. And the last, be strong and courageous, is the one that becomes very personal and very present. Be strong and courageous, for I am with you. So many leaders I've known have felt utterly alone. So many leaders I've known long before they should have, are virtually curled up in a fetal position, hoping that the world won't knock on their door because they feel they're utterly alone and abandoned by everyone. That's the experience, believe me, of a lot of leaders who haven't made it. The antidote to that is the encouragement that is to be found by knowing that we have a personal walk with God. Jesus said, "I am with you even to the end of the age." And just as I was with Moses. Yeah, Moses was a big figure. He was a magnificent figure, but I'm with you now. Moses, my servant, is dead. You now are the one that has to take over. Now, Jim and I and Walt and Rod aren't literally dead, but as far as the... But as far as the office of president is concerned, we are. We're out of it. We're done. Jeff, it's on your shoulders now. But no matter what the circumstances, God has said, as I was with Jim, as I was with Carl, as I was with Walt, as I was with Rod, so I will be with you. And you need that encouragement. You need individuals who will encourage you in the name of Christ. And I had them. Every one of us who have been in this office have had them. I could name some of those people who gave me courage. I just mentioned a couple of them. Roger, two of the chairmen of the board I had, Dick Richards and Fred Lang, were an enormous encouragement to me. Brian Sutherland was an enormous encouragement to me. The faculty, the community was an enormous encouragement to me. We don't have a top-down administration. We have a community. We're here to encourage and strengthen one another. Which brings me to my last point, Jeff. What's the most important job you have? I would say it's to encourage. To encourage vision. To encourage people. To encourage individual performance. To tell people on the faculty of the student body, you can be more than you ever thought you could be. And this vision of a Regent College is here, that we might be one of those vehicles God has given to help every one of us to become mature in Christ and to be more than, humanly speaking, we ever could be. Jeff, you're the chief encourager, and for that, you need courage. And we're here to encourage you. But above all, you find your courage in Christ, who is with you and with us now and to the end of the age. Be encouraged and strengthened, my friend. The best is yet to come. Amen?
Please stand to join in singing Lord of the Nations.
Granted us each other and
Please be seated. We enter now into the formal act of installation, which until a few minutes ago I thought was the installation of the fifth president of Regent College. Slightly confused on that. The act of installation and the wording associated with it is in your program. And following some questions to Jeff, I'll have one question for us as participants to affirm as well. Jeff, do you affirm and embrace the call of God on your life and ministry to serve as president of Regent College?
I do, and by the grace of God, I will.
Do you affirm and embrace the theological statement and beliefs held by Regent College?
I do, and by the grace of God, I will.
Do you affirm and embrace the mission of Regent College to cultivate intelligent, vigorous, and joyful commitment to Jesus Christ, His church, and His world?
I do, and by the grace of God, I will.
Jeff, do you affirm and embrace your responsibility to do all in your ability to exercise wise leadership as president of Regent College?
I do, and by the grace of God, I will.
And to those gathered, will you, as representatives of the community of God's people, seek as you are able to support Jeffrey Greenman in his leadership of Regent College?
Great.
Jeff, as a tangible sign of the office of president and symbolic of Regent's place in the world, I offer you this medallion. Representatives from various constituencies. Jeff, on behalf of the Board of Governors, those of us to whom is entrusted the oversight of Regent College, we collectively affirm your call to serve amongst us and receive your ministry among us.
On behalf of the faculty, those who serve you in the pursuit of the college's mission, we affirm your call to serve alongside us and receive your leadership among us.
On behalf of the staff, those who serve with you in supporting and facilitating the college's mission, we affirm your call to serve alongside us and receive your leadership among us.
On behalf of students, those who will learn from your teaching and grow under your care, we affirm your call and receive your ministry among us.
I invite you to join with us in prayer for Jeff. Gracious and loving God, we come to this day in thankfulness and hope for bringing Jeff to us, to serve amongst us, to lead us, to guide us, and be amongst us. As we do, Father, I pray that you would primarily and first of all guard his heart. As redeemed and bought back by your Son, that you would protect his heart, anchor it to your word, and help him seek under its authority all those things he'll require for this role. Father God, I pray that you would give him perspective, that he might see in this day what has gone before, where we sit now, and what might be Regent College's place in the future. Grant him wisdom to discern the excellent way from among the very many good alternatives, that we might be compelled by your word and your way to seek in holiness the path you've got before us. God, grant him courage, as has already been indicated, to call this community forward in purpose, in clarity, that we might be changed, and that we might speak into and provoke this place, this culture, and this time in ways that would be pleasing to you. I pray for Jeff and his family, that you would make in his home a safe place, that he there and here would be protected, be with his wife, his children, that they together might find these days joyful days, rewarding days, encouraging days, and that they might see their husband and father live out his calling in this place. Father, we bring these things to you with boldness and with courage, knowing that your Son walked the turbulent line of this life in holiness and faithfulness and offers this your servant Jeff, your Holy Spirit, to guide him, protect him in his leadership of this place. And in his name we pray. Amen.
Well, thank you everyone for being here. I know many of you have come a very, very long way and made quite an effort to be here. And I'm deeply grateful for that. It is a tremendous encouragement, speaking of that, to see you here. And I look out and see so many people that have meant so much to me for so long. I'm really grateful for your presence here to support me and what I'm called to do, as well as to support Regent College. And many of you are ones who have had a very long history with Regent. This is a day of celebration, isn't it? A day of celebration of Regent's history and mission. That's what I've been telling people I really wanted this to be about. Not so much about me, per se, but about God's faithfulness to Regent. We need to celebrate together. Sometimes when you go through hard times, as we have as a college in recent times, it's good to pause and give thanks, pause and celebrate, and maybe even have a party. But first and foremost, this is a worship service. That's why this is not just a gathering or a ceremony, but a installation service. That's true of Regent's institutional history and identity. We've wanted to operate out of a center in worship throughout our entire history. So we're here to give thanks and praise to God, Father, Son, and Spirit, for all of his goodness and faithfulness to Regent over so many years, through as many presidents as we may have had. Count them as you wish. The reality is that Regent as a project from the very beginning was raised up by the Spirit. That's what we believe. This isn't simply a human project, but what God was aiming to do in and through a certain group of people in a far-flung place called Vancouver. We're just here as stewards and trustees of what God aims to do, really. So this isn't about really me or whoever is supposed to be in charge, because we trust that this is God's place. Regent belongs to God. He raised it up, he has guided us, provided for us, and it belongs ultimately to him. It seems right to borrow from Newton's famous hymn to say something like, "Through many dangers, toils, and snares, Regent College already has come. 'Tis grace has brought Regent safe thus far, and grace will lead us on." So it's an occasion for us to stop and to reflect a little bit about our history. Appreciate Carl's note that points us backwards to appreciate the history of what God has done with his people and what God has done at Regent over time. It's an occasion to think back with deep gratitude and, I think, renewed appreciation for the remarkable vision and the sacrifice of many founding fathers and mothers of Regent. Many of them are here today. Some of our original founders and founding board members are with us. Thank you for being here. We want to honor you for your sacrifice and your contribution, for the remarkable forward thinking that that group of people way back in the early 1960s, mid-60s had for a college that could be eventually Regent. For instance, if you're curious as to how Regent got the most peculiar name Regent, you could ask Ken Smith, who is here today. He knows that story. It's a great story. I'm not going to tell it. I won't spoil it for you. But the founding fathers and mothers, you know what you did for the sake of this college, and we are deeply grateful to you. Today, I want to honor you. And I want to pay a special personal tribute to three such founding fathers, Jim and Carl and Ward Gass down here. I'll see if I can get through this. Each one has played a huge role in my experience as a student at Regent way back when. Probably there were dinosaurs then on the earth. Long time ago, there were two scruffy-looking little fraternity houses and some rather smelly portable units that was our building. Those were the days, weren't they, folks? But I'm quite sure that apart from the care and influence and true encouragement of these three people, I wouldn't be standing here today. And of course, it's not just Jim and Carl and Ward, it's Jim and Rita, Carl and Betsy, Ward and Laurel. Jim befriended me when I was working in Washington, D.C., and we had some lunches together. He helped me to see what Regent was all about. I didn't know much about it. Helped me to see that it was sort of place that was made for people like me, and opened up to me a wonderful vision as my teacher and friend, a vision of Christian personhood, I'd call it, maturity in Christ, something that has taken deep root in me and in my teaching and writing. And then, of course, I was Carl's TA. I was thought he might tell some stories. I'm kind of glad he didn't about those days. But Carl was a marvelous mentor and continues to be. He showed me the ropes. He taught me what a theological school was all about and how it worked, which calls to mind the phrase about not wanting to see how sausages are made. He encouraged me very deeply to use the administrative and leadership gifts that he saw in me, and he modeled for me a prayerful and humble and gracious leadership style. And it was really alongside of Carl that I discovered my vocation, my lifelong vocation to leadership and theological education. Ward, bless you, Ward, during his time as dean of what was then Ontario Theological Seminary, now Tyndale, glad to have Gary here, the president of Tyndale is with us. Ward opened a door for me. He called me up out of the blue. I was just writing my doctoral dissertation in the peace and quiet of my basement in Charlottesville, called me out of the blue and said he had a vision for a new program at what was then OTS. He gave me an opportunity. He opened a door. And he showed me what innovation really can be in theological education, even when a school had no money. And boy, did we have no money. And I was very privileged to be his successor as dean at Tyndale. So these three founding fathers, apart from them, I really wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be the person I am, and I wouldn't have learned what I've learned to come to this day. So to Jim and to Carl and to Ward, a special, special thank you. So let's celebrate the God to whom we worship today. Let's celebrate the one for whom Regent exists. Let's celebrate God's grace and faithfulness. Let's celebrate the vision and the sacrifice of our founding fathers and mothers. And I invite you to give thanks with me and celebrate the mentors that have meant so much to me. It's also a day, I think, to celebrate the mission of Regent. Much about Regent has changed over 45 years. Thankfully, the frat houses are a distant memory. A great deal has changed even in the past year as we went through a very difficult period of financial stress and institutional reorganization. But one thing that we should all understand and realize and celebrate is that our mission has not changed. What Regent is all about has remained remarkably consistent throughout our history. I'm often asked how Regent is different now from when I was a student back in the 80s when those dinosaurs were on the earth. The answer really is that there is far, far more that is the same than what is different. It was 25 years between my graduation and my return to the faculty and as dean, and certainly the cast of characters had substantially changed, although my history professor, Don Lewis, keeps on teaching now in his 312th year of service. You have to be careful when you say things and people like that are behind you. But so much is the same. I just noticed that so much the vision and the values and the ethos and even the vocabulary is so much the same. There is a very powerful institutional DNA in Regent, so that one generation picks up where the other has left off. In a sense, the baton is passed from one generation of faculty and student to the next. So remarkably the same. There's still soup. There's still chapel on Tuesdays. There's still a bunch of really adorable quirks. It's a wonderful place, but so much is the same. Primarily the mission, the focus, the vision is so much the same. Why Regent? What was the Regent project in the first place? What was in the hearts of those founding fathers and mothers? Well, the title in my address is trying to summarize it in six words: whole persons, whole people, whole world. That's pretty cryptic, but I like those words. Less cryptically, it's about fostering a deep and integrated Christian faith lived out by the whole people of God in every sphere of society in the whole world. It's pretty audacious, actually. Those are my words to put some understanding around what the founding fathers and mothers had in mind, and I think it's what Regent has always really been about, and I say that it will be what we pursue in the future. One of the roles that I cherish as president is to be a custodian of Regent's history. One of the things that I have up my sleeve, I can even show you right here, a little document. I love these sort of documents. This is called The Aims and Spirit of Regent College, and I can confidently date it with the help of our librarians to 1971. Here it is. Marvelous things you find in archives. So the Aims and Spirit of Regent College says this. It says that Regent exists to help young graduates upgrade their understanding of the Christian faith, to train them to become effective Christians in their own professions and leaders in their churches. Oh yeah, you say, that sounds right, and I think you should find all of that very familiar. It's still what we're on about. It's actually a very revealing statement. Let me just parse that a little bit for you. Regent exists to help students grow in faith, both in understanding of that faith and in the living of it out. That commitment is right here in this early document, a founding document, maybe constitutionally founding document in some ways. Understanding and living it out, both. And that commitment to both, a both and, rather than either or approach, is characteristic of Regent. And that commitment to what I'll call a lived faith is a Regent hallmark. This reference to an upgraded understanding of Christian faith is parsed out as an understanding primarily and first and foremost of scripture that leads us into good and healthy theology. But it's also giving equal weight to this idea of being effective Christians, is the phrase it uses. Effective in living out a faith that is put into action. A faith that is not simply thought about, but a faith that is lived, and a faith that is shared. So there's more to this than simply the transmission of ideas. It's about the transformation of persons. That has been at the heart of Regent, and is at the heart of Regent, and will be at the heart of Regent. Yes, it has always been a graduate school. Ideas matter. We actually earned our degrees, and students still do earn their degrees. We're not giving them away. Ideas do matter a lot. Regent's always been a place with high academic standards and has offered real depth and substance. But it's aspired to be a really different kind of graduate school. Not a graduate school defined by the ends of the academy, but defined really by the ends of the church. A deepened faith through study that would transform the whole of a person's life, heart and mind and soul and strength, as that great text from Deuteronomy reminds us. Shaping a whole person has been there from the beginning, an embodied, relational, social, living, breathing creature, not just a head on a stick, not just a thinking being, but thinking's important too, of course. Scholarship matters, but it's not an end in itself. Showing off for the academy is not the point. But drawing deeply on the best of the Christian heritage, the deepest Christian thinking, and the profoundest truths of Scripture, for the sake of cultivating a Christian mind and living a Christian life, that's something different. And that's what Regent has been about, what I call lived faith. And the word that, of course, has emerged around Regent, and not exclusively Regent, but certainly at Regent very deeply, to describe this kind of learning is to talk about the word integration, the connection between truth and life. This word integration is meant to capture. Most people live frazzled and fractured and fragmented lives in our frazzled and fractured and fragmented world. It's more so now than it was in 1970, for sure. Still, for most Christian people, Sunday and Monday are separated by a pretty deep chasm, still today. Daily work and ordinary life are often disconnected from the realities of faith. And Regent's insight, which is so powerful, is that if you're aiming to be a faithful pastor or a missionary or an accountant or a dentist or, dare I say, even a lawyer or a scholar, the same thing is utterly central and urgently needed, a deep and integrated faith that is lived out in every area of life. And integration speaks to the putting together of the puzzle, the pulling of pieces together, the fitting together in connection, rather than scatteredness and disconnection. And the hallmark of Regent's mentality has been that this is for all Christians. It's been for everybody. It's not just for the elite. It's not just for the few. It's not just for those that will be pastors. In our shorthand phrase, it is for the whole people of God. What a great and rich phrase that is. A phrase that we still fail ultimately in the church to take seriously, I think. And that document back from 1971 really calls people from all walks of life into this process of transformational learning, assuming that ministry happens anywhere and everywhere, not just by clergy and not just within the walls of a church. The whole people of God serving God in every area of life, in truly the whole world. And what we mean, of course, by whole world is whole world, all of its geography, but all of its culture and all of its sociology as well. Our students have come over the years from every corner of the globe and returned to every corner of the globe from over 100 nations. And they have done so, I think, on the basis of an understanding of ministry is everywhere. It is in every nook and cranny of our culture. It is needed in all sorts of places to be representatives and ambassadors for Christ. So that's my shorthand. Transformative education for whole persons, the whole people of God, for the whole world. One of the things that I've done over the last number of months, I'm installed today, but actually started this job back in February. I've done quite a bit of talking to a lot of people, a lot of travel over the summer to meet with our alumni, our friends, our supporters, our prayer partners, our donors. And I've asked them what they really think Regent is all about. And what they keep coming back to is this sense over and over of a deep and integrated faith. And this mission that I've been talking about, I have rehearsed with a number of people, and I keep getting the same response over and over and over. Yes, that is just as relevant, just as vital, just as important, just as necessary as ever. And one of these folks said to me, now more than ever, which gives you my title for today. Now more than ever, there's a need, there's a hunger, there's a desire, there's a compelling nature to this kind of vision. So as we celebrate this wonderful history and God's faithfulness to us, I want also to take a moment to celebrate the faculty. The faculty whose scholarship, teaching, mentoring, hospitality, friendship, pastoral care, and so much more has made an impact on the lives of so many. And I know that because Janet and I benefited so deeply from these people when we were here as students. And as I've said before, my motivation as president is to enable students now and in the years ahead to have the same kind of experience that I had. An education that was intellectually challenging, theologically robust, spiritually stretching, personally enriching, communally experienced, and utterly life-giving. So together, let us give thanks to God for calling together over the years a really remarkable assembly of people to serve as the faculty. From all over the world, different backgrounds, different denominations, various scholarly fields, assorted forms of ministry, God has provided Regent with faculty who are men and women of deep faith, who have loved Christ, loved the church, loved the scriptures, loved the life of the mind, and loved our students. Out of their shared intellectual and spiritual life, all of Regent's ministry has flowed. These faculty are really the heart and soul of Regent. They embody its mission, its vision, its ministry. To all of you faculty, past and present, I say, we thank our God with every remembrance of you. We thank you for your sacrifice, your dedication, your perseverance, your faithfulness, and your love. Would all of you who are past or present faculty please stand so that we can acknowledge you. Over time, the faculty have come together to frame a shared theological project that is actually quite distinctive. There's a cohesion and a coherence and a depth that marks what Regent has been about and what Regent has been teaching over all of these years, and it's quite distinctive. I'm very familiar with lots of theological schools, but I don't think any that has as clear a sense of what we're about theologically. So for those of you who like theology, here comes a few minutes. For those of you who are looking for an opportunity to nap, this might be your opportunity. For those of you who are students, all of this should sound very familiar, and this is the point where you start nodding your heads, okay? If it isn't familiar, we have somehow failed, or you're not very far along in your studies. But I want to say a little bit about this, and the reason is that many descriptions of theological education, what's going on in theological education, the future of theological education, don't talk really about the content of theological education. And the content is really, really important. Regent has come together not simply to be a school, but to be a school that has a particular kind of theological vision. So let me just say something about that. Here we go, in compressed rapid-fire form, starting with this. A deep biblical understanding is utterly essential, especially in an era of biblical illiteracy. Being shaped by the biblical story is foundational for every aspect of life and is basic to all other theological learning. Scripture reveals the faithful character of the true and living God, who became human in Jesus, whose death and resurrection is the centerpiece of God's purposes for his creation. The biblical story calls us to recognize our status as creatures of God, living in God's good world, God's creation. A high view of creation is indispensable. The gospel is the announcement of the arrival of the world's true king, Jesus Christ, who has inaugurated his kingdom. Theological depth flows from biblical depth, the biblical depth that it seeks to communicate, and is enriched by drinking deeply from the church's tradition across the centuries. Christ-centeredness is the hallmark of all authentic Christian thinking, as Jesus Christ is Lord of creation, Lord of the church, and Lord of the new creation. The biblical story reveals the triune God, so a robust Trinitarianism is key to right thinking about everything related to God and right living in his world. The church is fundamentally a people, the renewed people of God who are sent into the world in the power of the Spirit to bear witness to Christ in word and deed. The role of pastoral leadership is fundamentally equipping the saints for the work of ministry, to take up their own role as active partners in God's work in the world. That's why Ephesians 4 was read today. That's why Ephesians 4 is the cornerstone of the building. As you go over to lunch, have a look at it. Ministry is the broad category applicable to all Christians, not reserved for clerical professionals, but distributed widely through spiritual gifts. The basic Christian vocation to follow Christ can and should be lived out according to God's guidance in every area of life and culture. The church is called to faithful, discerning engagement with culture in its many expressions, avoiding either retreat from the world into a kind of fearfulness, Carl, or accommodation to the world's ways through compromise. Spiritual formation is a process of growing into the experience of new life in Christ toward becoming like Christ through the gifts of God's Spirit and his work in the human life. And theology, which is faith-seeking understanding, flourishes in the atmosphere of worship and prayer and aims ultimately at doxology, giving praise to God. Now, I realize that's a great deal of very compressed, rapid-fire theology and even some technical theological language, but hey, I'm a theologian. It's all bundled up in a very compressed way. But the point I want to make is that that is a rich set of ingredients in what I would call the secret sauce of the Regent education. There is an intellectual and spiritual food that feeds people's hearts and minds. And ultimately, our students come because they're hungry. They're hungry for a nutritious theological meal. They're hungry for a renewal of heart and mind. They're hungry to discern their vocation and how God will use them in his world. And in the process of that, it is not simply to come under the green roof and to have something magical happen to you. It is to engage with our faculty deeply to be formed into a way of thinking that reflects all of what I have reflected here. The lordship of Christ over every area, the glory of the triune God, experience through the depth of learning of the scriptural narrative. So as I say, it seems important to me to note what Regent actually has been about, substantially, content-wise, teaching-wise. What has this faculty been saying year after year in classes, after all? What have they been writing in those books? What they've been doing is developing a kind of local variation, a kind of microclimate of evangelical Protestantism, a kind of classical evangelical orthodoxy with a bit of a Regent flair to it. It's a kind of evangelicalism, and this is for the benefit of scholars of such like Tim Larson in our midst, so that he can add this to a footnote to one of his future papers. Regent microclimate, evangelicalism, confident in God, in Scripture, and in the Gospel, aiming to avoid being narrow, obscurantist, defensive, or rigid, but rather aiming to be gracious, hospitable, curious, open to learning from other theological traditions. And it has been and needs to continue to be wary of various deadly isms: rationalism, anti-intellectualism, individualism, legalism, pragmatism, triumphalism, sentimentalism, add your favorite ism. But on this day of celebration, I want to also just give thanks for this remarkably gifted faculty and for the theological vision that has propelled this college and animated its ministry. This is a faculty that have taught and preached and prayed and written and mentored out of a very cohesive vision. It is a wonderful treasure, and I want to say it is also vital and important and necessary now more than ever. So having celebrated God's faithfulness to Regent in our history, the vision, our mission, this faculty that is so remarkably the theological heritage that has developed in our microclimate, finally, I just want to spend a couple of minutes looking toward the future. The reason why I've spent so much time on history and on mission and on theology is this. My sense is that the future comes out of the past. Regent's future will emerge from its history as the further development of a strong and beautiful tree with deep roots, a tree that is planted in very fertile soil, a tree that is growing to fulfillment and maturity and blossoming and beauty that is yet to come. And with Carl, I also hope and pray that the best is yet to come for Regent. I've been talking about what kind of tree this Regent tree is in its microclimate, what shape the tree is, and who some of the shapers have been. Trees grow. They need to grow. They change over time. And yet, they remain the same. They become more of what they're designed to be. They grow into their purpose. You might even say they fulfill their calling, all through growth. So a question then before us might be this: how should Regent grow and change in order to remain the same? How should Regent grow and change in order to become the fully flourishing, beautiful, flowering tree that God intends? Cognizant of the election just passed, I want to say that this speech is not a speech from the throne in Parliament with a detailed legislative agenda. Now is not the time for that kind of thing. But it is a time, I think, to name some of our challenges and to identify the spirit and attitudes that we need moving forward. As we press on in offering transformative, integrative theological education for the whole people of God, our challenge is to find the best ways to do that, what Roger has referred to as the excellent way. Given all of the significant changes in our culture, in our economic climate, in the church, in higher education, we live in an age of great, great change. We live in a world very different from the world of the 1960s that gave birth to Regent. And yet there are so many opportunities before us, so many open doors. Let me just raise a few questions. If Regent's original premise was opening access to high quality, transformative learning and towards a deep and integrated faith, what will that look like in the future? What will opening up access to deep transformative learning look like in the future? If access was the thing, opening up something that previously had been closed to those that were hungry for it, what will opening up access mean? If Regent's origins lie in innovation, creativity, and boldness, as certainly they did, what will innovation, creativity, and boldness look like in the years ahead? If Regent's founding fathers and mothers were faithful to God in their generation by reading the signs of the times and by getting ahead of the curve the way that they did, what are the signs of today's times we need to pay attention to? How can we stay ahead of the curve like they did? If Regent was born from the labor of love by people who answered the call of God to sacrifice, and sacrifice they did, their time and energy and prayer and financial resources towards making something possible, this dream that eventually became Regent, how will God raise up such people now and in the generation ahead? Who will they be? How will they hear the call of God to join in this project? I think those are some pretty good questions. As we seek answers to all those kinds of questions together, I want to suggest that we need to live into our future with some commitments. Commitment to being a community that operates with realism while maintaining the highest ideals. Rarely has there been a community with such high ideals as this one. It's beautiful. Being a community that is marked by unity of heart and mind and purpose. Being a community that is known for collaboration and partnership. Being a community that demonstrates accountability and transparency in all aspects of our organizational life. And first and foremost, being a community that seeks God first and desires to go where God's Spirit leads in faithfulness. So now is a time for gratitude, a day of celebration. Now is a time for deep dependence upon God as our provider. Now is a time for renewed faith. Regent has been so deeply blessed by God to be a peculiar kind of gift to his church, and we are peculiar. A gift to the church and to the world, a learning community with a strategic mission, a compelling vision, and a vibrant theology, all of which is just as vital and compelling and needed now more than ever. Therefore, on this day of celebration, let us turn again to God and say this. Now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations, forever and ever. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Thank you so much, Jeff, for your leadership and your gift among us. And now let us continue to celebrate God's goodness to us in prayer. Eternal God, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you gave birth to the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. You created the vast galaxies in all their splendor. You fashioned this magnificent creation we enjoy all around us, especially here in Vancouver, with the mountains and ocean, the wildlife and the trees ablaze with your radiant glory this autumn. And you lovingly formed humanity in your own image, with the desire and capacity to commune intimately with you. Though humans turned against you, you formed a people to be your holy and treasured possession. Not because they were greater or more numerous than other nations, but so that you might demonstrate your covenant loyalty and redeem all peoples of the earth. Over the ages, you have gently tended and nurtured your people, despite their frailties and failings, and you repeatedly called them to be your witnesses among the nations. Then you revealed yourself ultimately in the person of Jesus, who lived among us on earth, was crucified and raised from the dead to restore us into right relationship with you and to manifest the abundant life you intend for us. And now you invite us into the immense privilege of knowing you more fully through Christ, loving you more deeply through the Spirit, and participating with you as the triune God in your redemption of all creation. Lord God, we as the Regent College community long to find our place in you and to embrace our identity and calling within your eternal purpose of reconciling all things in Christ. Like your people established long ago, we are not more numerous or greater than other communities in and of ourselves. And yet with a deep sense of humility, awe, and gratitude, we attest the mighty works that you have accomplished and that you continue to accomplish in and through Regent College. And so we stand in this moment of transition with a profound sense of Ebenezer. Thus far you have helped us. We look back with wonder and thanksgiving. We celebrate the present with intense joy. And we anticipate the future with deep hope in the assurance that you hold Regent College in the palm of your hand. We thank you for our leadership, for our founding fathers and mothers who discerned your calling in establishing Regent and who committed themselves wholeheartedly to its vision and mission of holistic, transformative learning. For our former principals and presidents, Dr. Jim Houston, Dr. Carl Armerding, Dr. Walt Wright, and Dr. Rod Wilson, as well as our new president, Dr. Jeff Greenman. For all the board members over the decades who have provided spiritual, administrative, and financial oversight to the college. We thank you for our faculty, both previous and present, who have cultivated and committed their gifts of scholarship and mentoring to build significantly into generations of students. For our staff, whose professionalism and tireless diligence undergird our everyday functioning as a college. For our donors and friends who have given sacrificially of themselves to sustain Regent prayerfully and financially. And most of all, Lord, we give you deep thanks for our students, for all our alumni across the globe, for our current students, and for those who are yet to come. We pray that in your grace, you would allow them to flourish in the various capacities in which they serve. For those in the academy, that they would be marked by teaching and writing with clarity and wisdom, and by being deeply relational with colleagues and students. For those in the church, that they would proclaim and live out the gospel as Jesus did, by the power of your Holy Spirit, in word and in deed. For those in the marketplace, that in their everyday work, they would manifest Christ-like character and kingdom values, and that you would empower them as catalysts to transform their communities for your name's sake. Lord, we also pray for the wider world this day. Loving God, please have mercy on your creation. Restore calm following the hurricane in Mexico. Bring peace to the turmoil of the Middle East. Provide homes and security for the countless migrants. Frustrate the schemes of those who plot evil nationally, internationally, and interpersonally. Help politicians speak and act with truth and integrity, particularly in the new government here in Canada. We turn to you, Lord, to renew the earth in its entirety and to allow your life to flourish within Regent and throughout the world. And so we declare in the words of Psalm 86, all the nations you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name. For you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God. Teach us your way, Lord, that we may rely on your faithfulness. Give us undivided hearts, that we may fear your name. We will praise you, Lord our God, with all our hearts. We will glorify your name forever, for great is your love toward us. All this we pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Tony Payne, and as a former colleague of Jeff's and friends with my wife of Janet and Jeff, it's such a privilege to be here, and I can tell you that any friends of the Greenmans are friends of ours. We're so happy and privileged to be sharing a new hymn today in honor of Jeff's inauguration. Jeff and Janet helped me shape this hymn so that it would be steeped in the Regent mission and would reflect the talk that he gave today. And I'm very happy about the way it turned out. I hope you like it. The tune is named Greenman in honor of our dear friends. And there are three great streams that flow into the tune. One is the great gospel song tradition that shaped so much of our evangelical faith. One is the great classical hymn tradition that especially comes to bear at a special occasion like this. And the third is the contemporary Christian tradition, which is so much a part of our lives and our churches today. I hope you'll see all of that woven together and in joyful conversation. So I'm going to have help with these wonderful musicians that have been on the platform with me. And I invite you to come and join us by standing and singing Festival Hymn to the Trinity.
Please be seated.
Well, friends, that brings us to the place in the program where I need to give you a few instructions and announcements. I can tell you that in an earlier draft of this document, which was handed to me by the president's office, all it said here was, Paul says lots of stuff. So there's a bit of stuff I have to tell you now. So this is all very important. So the most important thing is the first thing I'm going to say, which is this, that following the ceremony, you're all invited to join us for lunch over at the college. So if you forget everything else, that's the main thing to hold on to. Next point, there is parking available in the Regent lot until it's full, and then there isn't. Okay, there are 4 wheelchair accessible spots available. There's also ample parking available at other places around, street parking and other lots and so on, and there will be a parking attendant to direct you to other locations once the Regent College lot is full. When you do arrive at the college, you will be greeted by one of these ubiquitous hosts who will give you directions of where to go. So once again, if you forget everything, there will be somebody there that you can ask. There will be a self-check cloakroom downstairs where you are welcome to leave your coat, but the room will not be attended, so please don't leave any valuables there. There will also be an information desk in the south atrium. That's the big atrium. Should you have any questions about anything, there will be an information desk. Lunch will be served in 5 different locations throughout the building. 2 of them will be on the upper level, there'll be 2 on the main level, and also 1 in the lower level. So look around for a place to find your lunch. Once you've collected your lunch, we encourage you to move into one of the various seating areas which are scattered throughout the building. There's no reserved seating, so just find a good place to enjoy your lunch with the people that you like. And then once again, hosts will be present all the time to help you find where you ought to go if you're a little bit lost or bewildered or anything like that. Now, one of the rooms where lunch will be served is room 100. Some of you will know where that is. That room is going to be used later on for the symposium. So at 1:30, those who are having their lunch in that room will kindly be asked to move out for a little while in order for the room to be set up. The lookout gallery is going to be open the whole time, showing the work of Tofino artist and Regent alumnus Dan Law, so you're welcome to enjoy that. The library is closed, but our research librarian, Cindy Alders, will be in the library from 1 to 2 to show you around if you would like to see that. Then, the academic symposium begins at 2 o'clock in room 100 and in the chapel. And details of the schedule of that will be found in brochures that you will be able to pick up at the college. And the symposium is a series of panel discussions and presentations on the theme, What Future?, which looks at the future of theological education, of evangelicalism, of women in leadership in the church, marketplace, and academy, and the future of theological books and of congregational singing. There will be some Q&A time as well, so I'm sure you could talk about any other kind of future you want to as well. And the symposium features a number of our distinguished visitors from other schools and from various ministry organizations. So please feel free and welcome to join in on the symposium. So to come back to what we're doing, we're going over to the college for lunch, so please do come. The building closes at 4:30. So that's just the final time you need to know. Once the building is closed, you got to be out of there. No, not really. But the thing is coming to an end by 4:30 so that the building can be set up for next week. So we do look forward to seeing you over at the college. And now Susan Phillips will come for the benediction. Please stand.
Please join me in praying a benediction on our president of Regent College, Jeffrey Greenman, and feel free to extend a hand of blessing toward Jeff if you like. Let's pray. O God, we pray your grace and blessing on your servant, Jeff Greenman, as he leads the precious college and community of Regent. Continue to cultivate the work of his head as he leads this world-class school of Christian thought and scholarship. May his mind be keen and adept, discerning and courageous in scholarship, leadership, and discipleship. Continue to open Jeff's heart to you and to the people entrusted to his care, stretching his heart that your grace may flow into it and through it. May he be fortified by the affirmation of your call in his life, the sustaining graces of love in his family, friendships, community, and vocation, and the joy of walking the path you have laid out before him. Continue to strengthen Jeff's hands as he holds the guiding reins of this ministry, this college, helping all of us to put our own hands to the loving work of Christ in the world. May he sense your hands shaping his soul, even as he extends his hands in willing service. O God, bless Jeff's head, heart, and hands in the presidency of Regent College, as he and those of us who serve alongside him as staff, faculty, governors, students, alumni, and supporters, cultivate intelligent, vigorous, and joyful commitment to Jesus Christ, his church, and his world. And so, in the words of the Apostle Paul, we say to you, Jeff, go forth into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you always. Amen.
Please remain standing while we sing the Regent Hymn.